All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon, trying to break it all down out here on the West Coast. It's beautiful. It's Monday, February 27th. Again, thank you guys so much. Everybody who's rocking with me in the off season. Again, a lot of people maybe fall off during football season. Got a lot of basketball still to talk about. Got a lot of football still to talk about. Got a lot of whatever else you want to chat about. Still doing live streams. If you guys are staying abreast on that, if you want to try to follow along with that, get me on Twitter or whatever else. I try to post that, and I also try to do interviews. Try to have some of the guys come in who cover the team. I've had a couple guys on already. You should go check those out. They're in the live section. If you're used to getting the information here off of one side of it, you got to go to the other side of it. Again, I'm not that technologically savvy, but it is what it is. I like the live stream because I like to be able to kind of interact with the people, and I like to chat. How about that? This week, though, going to have Jared Denny on from Scoop Duck on 3. Jared does a great job. Knocks it out of the park. And then hopefully have Tyson Alger on as well. Love Tyson. Absolutely hilarious. If you don't follow and subscribe is a different way to do it over there. Than it is here, obviously, but I-5 corridor is tremendous. I am a member of what I don't know what you call it when you buy the sponsorship. I'm a sponsor. I don't know. I'm a supporter is what it is. And but his story about being on I-5's trapped is going to be absolutely insane. So I got to hear that. Yeah, we're excited. The tournament's going to be cracking in here for the women. They wrapped up their off season for the basketball. The men's tournament's going to be next week. I'm going to be in Vegas for that. I can't wait for that. It's going to be super awesome. So if anybody's down in Vegas and they want to hang and kick it sports chat style, let's go. Let's do this thing. This video has a bunch of different stuff. We still have the elephant in the room, which is this conference realignment. Everybody's favorite topic. Everybody's talking about this. Every time I talk to people now, I somehow have become some sort of representative for the Pac-12 or at least for the Ducks in my professional circle. So people always come to me to ask me any of these questions. I've had people ask me about this thing who I didn't even know followed football or even college athletics at all. So it's hitting a bunch of different populations, and so we got to talk about that. And then Oregon gets new coaches. And Brian Michalowski is one of them, inside linebacker coach now, and we've already talked about, over time, Mike Kavanaugh. I think maybe 2 or 3 different videos where we talked about this now, but I love the move with Kavanaugh because he's such a vet, such an old school guy, Michalowski, I'm from what I've seen, the guy's amped up, man. He's one of these coaches that repeats himself over and over and over. I love that. I'm an old school guy too. It's like, all right, hands up, hands up, hands up. You know, in a drill, you know, when you're there's something about coaching where you kind of almost like float above your body. It's a weird way to talk about it. Like in a drill or something, you get almost third person. You're looking at everything from different angles and you just go. You're just like in the zone. It's like you don't even think about it half the time. You just react, and oftentimes you start saying the same thing over and over and over, you know, and get down, you know. And so, you know, if you go back and watch, I watched some of his clips from Colorado where he is absolutely lit. And that's great. I love the energy. His energy would fit in great with these guys. But you know Dan Lanning has a special place in his heart, as every defensive-minded head coach should, for their inside linebackers. And having Jeff Boss, I think, really be the guy. Keith Brown, I think, as well, is going to have just an absolutely massive year. And then you have Justin Jacobs come over, you know, transfers. I think these transfers come over with, you know, like we'd say back in the day, with bad intentions. But I think these guys come in ready to play. They know what they need to do to be successful. I think that's the key thing. And if you know what you need to do and you can do it and you can stay healthy, dude, let's go. Some of these guys transfer and have their best year. So I think he, again, takes over a good group. You know, we saw this last year with Jake Long, right? And we're like, oh, he takes over one of the best groups of the country. Well, they struggled at times, and they couldn't quite figure out, it felt like to me, and among other people as well. I'm not the only one out here doing this stuff, right? There's a bunch of people talking about the Ducks. But from my perspective, as a guy who I played inside linebacker, they just didn't really have the mesh of the athlete to the scheme. And I think everybody has kind of hit on some form of this over time, right? These guys that they had were power smash A-gap type guys who didn't really open the hips very well. They didn't really open up and get back into the flat very well. And they didn't really cover the receivers very well or the tight ends. And and that's a tough ask. That's a really tough ask. But it feels like when you have Bosa come down from the safety, he was able to do a little bit of that. So it felt like he went into that role quickly as a guy who was really doing some things in there. And I really think Keith Brown kind of fits the mold as well. Although he can smash an A-gap up with the best of them. But really excited about this move, and it's an exciting time. So you have new coaches coming in before spring practice. Spring practice starts here in a couple days. You know, next week is a really exciting time. You know, you got the start of March coming up here, and it's starting to feel like spring. You know, I've had my golf practice start. I'm a golf coach at my school, and we started golf today. It's a really exciting time. It always kind of feels like a new time to kind of switch into a different gear and really dig into it, man. Get excited about this stuff, man. I love transitions, man. I love switching from one to the other, you know. Feels like you're done with the regular, you know, for women especially. They're done with the regular season. Now they go to their tournament. And they're playing really well at the end of the year. Let's go make a run at the tournament. See what happens, right? You're probably not going to get past Stanford in that second round. You got to play Washington first. That's a tough draw having Stanford second game. But go see what you can do. Go play well, right? And then same thing for the men. And everybody's dogging the men, right? Oh, this team is it's still the Ducks. Who else are you going to root for? I hate it when people, these Duck fans, man, they love to just bitch and complain about the Ducks. They're constantly like, this team isn't good enough. Well, rarely have they been. They won one national championship in 1939. Okay? Yeah, you're right? So, you know, that Final Four team to me was the best team I've ever seen assembled at Oregon. And I think with Boucher healthy, they probably win that game. They get that rebound. I always go back to that damn rebound. But the point is that you can still be happy with a team that doesn't win at all. It's not like you had to win the freaking championship to respect that team. You know? And this team doesn't play that well sometimes. And it's frustrating as hell. It's not like they're trying to lose. And it's not like the coaches are trying to lose. You people are like, fire Dana. Oh, yeah. Fire the Hall of Famer. Fire the guy who's the best coach this program's ever had. I get it. People are frustrated with it. I'm not trying to say you can't be frustrated. Hell, he's frustrated with it. You know, this team lost terribly early in the season. They got really dinged at the injury. Their transfers didn't come through with them early. They left them shorthanded. There were other guys who had left. You know, I mean, you know, it's just you can blame it on a bunch of stuff. And then they just didn't really play well early on. And but they kind of figured it out, and they got some things rolling, and they had some great games this year, and they beat some quality opponents. And I think every team is beatable in the Pac-12. UCLA has proven themselves as the number one team, but I think every team is beatable. So you just got to believe, man. You got to believe. So going into the last two games, you know, they should have won the two games at Washington. I get it. I'm pissed as well, dude. I was so frustrated when they lost to the Huskies. Ah! I hate that. You only play them one time. You played them more than you've played, than almost anybody's played anybody. There's some old school rivalries out here. You know, and, you know, not playing Washington is a killer at home, but you get to go up there and you get beat by them, and then they turn around and they look terrible the other day against Stanford. I watched that one because I watch everything as much as I can, man. I follow everything, especially the Ducks. I like to watch the team that's going to play the Ducks play the game before to see how they're going to play. And that's the next game I'm going to, is a Stanford game, but Cal is absolute ass cheeks, and they should be able to be stomped. But Cal, Stanford's always tough to sweep, and you couldn't do it down there. Stanford won, and so up here now Stanford's an issue, and that's the game I'm going to end the year, so I'm, you know, cognizant of that, right? But blah, 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 man. You just got to follow the Ducks. I not to say you can't complain. I'm not here to tell anybody to do they can't do anything, but that always frustrates me. It was just like, man, I get it. I'm pissed too. Okay, and then we got to talk about conference realignment. So we're going to talk about conference realignment this week when I have Jared on, when I have, Tyson on, anybody else who I talk with. Obviously, Spencer McLaughlin's got plenty of plenty of takes on it. Love being on his show. He was on the live stream the other day. Max Torres, Zach Neal's got his podcast now. You know, all these guys do a great job, man. The 247 guys, everybody out here, Flock Pod, man, everybody's doing their thing, man. So I appreciate all those dudes, man, and they're doing a great job with it. But man, I'm telling you, this conference realignment stuff. Speaking of another, Doug Scott, that QB11 show. Doug Scott is doing a great job on Twitter with all this stuff. He's nailing it. You know, he's talking about basically the sky is falling, which it is. He's talking about how, they probably aren't going to get the deal they want. And it's going to piss people off. And the number is going to piss people off. And it's going to make people scared. And they're going to talk about as much as they can. You know, Canzano was talking about it over and over and over today, which was, I get it. I mean, it's the number one talk of the town, right? Everybody wants to talk about conference realignment, right? You know, I've said it over and over and over. I think their best option is to go with just the 10. I don't think they really add that much value going to SMU. They add a new time zone, which they could play earlier, but they're already going to be in competition with those schools anyway. The one time slot they have control over that everybody wants is the late night spot. The late night time slot is the spot for them because it's theirs. They already have it, and it's theirs to give up at this point and let the freaking Mountain West or whoever else handle it. But basically, if the Pac-12 can keep it together, they're probably not going to get the deal they want. But if they could create some sort of deal where they're still on ESPN and ESPN doesn't let them completely die on the vine, but they go to the streaming package that helps them, the best, and they package the thing up. Well, the problem is that means ESPN and Amazon's going to have to work together on the deal, which they're not going to work together on the deal very well. That means you're going to have or Apple TV or YouTube TV or whoever else the streaming service is. It just means that you're going to be adding more and more pieces to the puzzle, which again was my point the last time, which was if you have some sort of cornucopia deal where it's a little bit from there and a little bit from there and a little bit from there and everything's all packaged up plus the streaming thing, that means you need to have a lot of things working together in concert to make that thing work. And good luck. Good luck getting all these things together for this deal. For this pack. They're not going to work that hard for this. They're not going to work that hard for the Pac-12. I do still think the Pac-12 is a quality product. But you don't have the population out here that you have on the East Coast. You don't. It's 2/3 of the population live east of the Mississippi. You don't have the TV viewership. You don't have the diehard viewership. You've got the SEC and the Big Ten. Those are the two biggest football regions of the country. You add the Big 12 to it, which is basically your package deal. And then you get your East Coast fill-in spots in Florida and all up and down the Atlantic with your ACC, which, again, I don't think is very strong either. But the way it looks right now is that you've got your SEC at number one, your Big Ten is slotted number two, you've just put basically your Big 12 at number three, and you've got the ACC at number four. You've been pushing and prodding and throwing out all this misinformation, disinformation, whatever the case, for all these years shitting on the Big Ten or shitting on the Pac-12. And the whole time, the Big Ten's gotten richer, the SEC's gotten richer. The Big 12 has gotten richer. The Big 12's adding teams. The Big 12's got, solid base behind it. The ACC's got the big, long original contract because they also like the basketball there. I mean, there's so many things involved here that are putting the Pac-12 behind the eight ball. And so what the hell is the Pac-12 going to do? You're never going to meet the number that those other schools are meeting. That's just not going to happen. And especially with SC and USC, UCLA leaving, that destroys your product. Your bottom line is destroyed by them leaving. Okay, and that's what we were saying last year. The writing was on the wall. But if you're able to keep the thing together, you still got a good basketball school in Arizona. You still got a good football school lately in Oregon, Washington, Utah. You know, you've got some things still put together. You still got quality academics. You've still got quality schools. You just don't really have the cachet. You need to start winning some stuff. You need to jump into some Final Fours and win something. You need to go into some CFPs and start winning stuff. And if you don't start winning stuff, you're done. And the only school to win any game in the CFP was Oregon in the first one. Yeah. That nobody's doing anybody any favors out here. You know, even the amount of talk USC has or UCLA, nobody's doing anybody any favors. Everybody needs everybody to win all the time. And that has not happened. You know, including Oregon. Oregon had their chances and they didn't win. I get it. I was there. I know. I felt it more than you did. Trust me. if you're a Doug fan, if you're some USC fan or whatever. I know. Sucked. So, yeah, everybody's talking about this conference realignment. It's not going to go well, I think, for the Pac-12. At the same time, I think that they don't want it to go well for the Pac-12. They want to squeeze the Pac-12, everything it's got it. They want to absolutely shit on it, put it to bed, and not have another competitor out here. And they got the two teams that anybody cares about. They got the area that anybody cares about, which is Los Angeles. And now the Big Ten can say, we're L.A. to New York. And we're basically, you know, highway, all the way from here to there, right? I mean, it's like Route 66, you know. And I get it, but I still don't think that USC, UCLA is going to bring that much to that table. But they're going to get a different time slot they can work in. And they're going to get all the different kind of storylines they can work in. And they got two great schools. So it's going to benefit them. You know, I don't think Oregon in any way, shape, or form is benefited by grabbing, you know, San Diego State and SMU, you know, comparatively to what they had with USC and UCLA. I think that's a big drop-off. I think anyone would agree. So, it's just one of those deals, man. But we'll continue to talk about this. You know, it's not going anywhere. Would Oregon jump? Can Oregon be independent? I've had all these conversations, all these questions. One, I don't think they can be independent because I don't think they can generate enough revenue. I think there's going to be a major gap there. I think they can. I think Oregon doesn't necessarily have to work. I think Oregon just needs to stay in a conference where they have a chance to go to the CFP. I think Oregon is a unique school because I think Oregon can generate money other ways. And same with Washington. I think Oregon and Washington, both, and Arizona. I think Arizona, I don't think you should underrate Arizona. I think Arizona has a major fan base, and I think they can do some things. In this next wave of what you used to think of as USC and UCLA, you better think of Arizona and Utah, because they both promote and they both do a great job with their athletic department, for the most part. Arizona is an ass kicker across the board. They fill up that arena in football and in basketball. They do a great job. So, in my mind, you know, you can do a 10 split. The pie is, you know, each size is bigger. You're not going to get the deal you want, but if you can maintain a relation with ESPN, it stays with your big games, stay on ESPN, and that keeps you in the loop. The other games, if they go from Pac-12 Network, which sucked, to a streaming service where people have access to it, at least I think that's an upgrade. And if there's money to go with it. But if they get like $35 million a year, I think Oregon can supplement it another $20 million a year or something. I don't know how long it's going to sustain. I don't know how long that's sustainable. But I think they could probably find a way to scrape together some sort of a collective on some sort of level to put together money that would really generate kind of a separation between, which they've already tried to do, between them and the rest of the conference. But I think Washington has that opportunity. I think Oregon has that opportunity. And again, we're talking athletically. These schools' academic budget far outweighs their athletic budget. Schools like OSU. But UCLA being the school that they were in basketball, it's just hard to be replaced, that school. And it's going to hard to be replaced USC in football. USC's got such damn tradition in both them in football and UCLA in basketball. It's going to be hard to replace those schools. But I do think Arizona is a great basketball school. And I think Utah is really building a really good football program and a good athletic program across their board. I think Colorado's got a lot of good history. I think Arizona State's, we've always said Arizona State's a sleeping giant, one of the biggest schools in the country, in one of the best places in the country, a booming population. The California schools, and then us, you know, I think it's really important to kind of look at, you know, how important Oregon and Washington is going to be to this next conference. And that's why I think that Oregon might want to stay. I think it might benefit Oregon to kind of stick with a team or a conference that's a 10-team conference where they're going to get a guaranteed entry to the CFP and be able to share whatever stake, maybe unequal revenue sharing or some other sort of thing. They're going to have to kind of figure out some sort of way, and they might actually write in a way where they can have an out or something if something else presents itself. But I do think that it's a stark difference between what Oregon and Washington can bring to the table versus some of the other schools around here. No insult to Oregon State or Washington State, but it's a tough situation for them. If there is a pilfering happens out of the Pac-10, and it could get real ugly. If you keep it together as Pac-10, I think it might actually sustain this storm, and it might actually be in a spot where they can be competitive in the future. I don't know what that's going to look like, but I think there's going to be a time where you're going to have to try to get through maybe 5-10 year period where you're going to have to kind of do more with less. You're going to have to get some wins, and you're going to have to create a more valuable product than what you have right now. So, all right, y'all. Thanks, guys, for watching Sports Chat 503. We'll see you guys next time. Adios.